So this has been a workshop on complex systems in general, right? And I think one of the most complex systems that we have out there is biology, right? And the recent years have seen a lot of emergence of computational techniques to study biological systems in greater detail. So I used to have a cartoon earlier, of let's consider a spherical cow in a vacuum, ignoring the effects of gravity and so on. Many of you may have seen that cartoon, right? So that's about how well we used to model a few decades ago, right? Because it used to be very difficult to build elaborate models of complex systems. Now, with the increase in the mathematical tools at our disposal and computational power, I think we've not been holding back. Right, we've been trying to build larger and larger and larger models of very complex systems. So I'll talk to you about some of these models today, especially one particular paradigm. If you look at biological systems, I generally like to think of three different ways to model biological systems broadly. There are other ways as well, but predominantly three different ways. The first is, classic, if the moment I use the word mathematical modeling, I think an ODE jumps to your mind, right? So ODEs are the most effective way to model the dynamics of any complex system, and of course in biology as well. But then immediately, what's limiting about ODEs? Is there anything limiting? Parameters. Parameter estimation becomes very challenging, right? If you have more than 20 odd parameters, good luck trying to find them, unless you have very nice constraints on the parameters, right? If a biologist came and told you that I expect the Km and Vmax of the enzyme to be in such and such a range, then it makes your parameter estimation a lot easier. If not, somebody once remarked, you're like not just searching for a needle in a haystack, you're searching in a needle in a haystack in a city full of haystacks. You don't even know which haystack to start looking in. Because it's that difficult, right? The space is really, if you're talking about R20, right? The space of real numbers in 20 dimensions, that's why you need to search for your parameters. It gets very, very challenging. And the other real challenge, particularly in biology, unlike other complex systems, is that there's a lot of sloppiness. Have you heard of the term before in this workshop? No? No. So sloppiness is not from the term of messy, but from the term of floppy, or not very rigid, right? So many systems could be quite rigid, whereas biological systems are very sloppy. In the sense, you can have very different parameters that can fit the same set of data. Right? So you can have a simple example, you can have high K1, low K2, low K1, high K2. Somehow they compensate for one another and you get the same behavior no matter. Right? So typically, of course, there are like fundamental questions about identifiability of biological systems and so on. I'll not even get into those things. But in general, it gets very difficult to estimate certain parameters, or get a unique identification of a parameter set. Right? So all these are challenges when you look at classic ODE-based modeling. And of course, by definition, because I've not spoken beyond 20, 25 parameters, you're limited to small systems. You want to model a signaling network, a regulatory network, you can do very well. Although people have been bravely modeling much larger systems. You can model as large systems as you want, there's really no restriction, except that you can't do parameter estimation. If you have respectable estimates of parameters from literature or first principles or whatever, then you're in good shape. Otherwise, you're going to be really struggling with the parameter estimation. So if you jump to the other extreme, that's where we have graph theory, right? So it predominantly ignores dynamics, although you can potentially consider dynamics. So it looks at a very high-level description of the system, just who interacts with who, essentially. Right? Does this protein interact with the other protein and so on? You can also have directed interactions, you can have gene regulatory interactions and so on. You can do centrality studies, identify important important nodes in networks, all that stuff. Beyond that, you can also do some discrete simulations. There are Boolean network-based simulations to study important nodes in signaling networks, so on and so forth. Right? So these are two extremes. Right in the middle, you have constraint-based modeling techniques, which can actually handle larger systems. So it's not uncommon to handle systems of thousands of reactions. and get some idea about the dynamics. You know, not truly dynamics, you know, you look at steady state, but you can also look at, you know, what happens when you start deleting something and how the system will evolve to a new steady state and so on. That's not a key strength of this method, but in general, you can get at least quantitative information about a system. Whereas, you know, from graph theory or, you know, you just get some sort of qualitative idea on what is the most important protein in the network and so on. So here you can get accurate estimates of growth rate of an organism and so on. And this has been, as Professor Venkatesh was mentioning yesterday, extremely useful in metabolic engineering. Right. So there are many applications of constraint-based methods. So that will be maybe my last slide. But let's just get on with what are constraint-based methods for simulating and analyzing metabolic networks. So you already have a pretty strong introduction to metabolism from yesterday, but nevertheless, let me repeat. So you're all familiar with the simple system of chemical reactions. Right? Some A plus B giving 2C, B plus 2C giving D, and so on. So these are the stoichiometric coefficients, right? So 1 mole of B reacts with 2 moles of C to give you 1 mole of D. Right? So the proportion in which they react is fixed. This is a real system of reaction. This is the glycolysis pathway that all of us keep alluding to. Right? You have glucose plus ATP giving glucose 6-phosphate and finally giving 2 moles of pyruvate. Right? And this is like a real system of metabolic networks, and I usually like to call it a simplified version of what really happens, right? So the real system is infinitely more complex. So here I'm just showing you a snapshot of just the metabolites, right? So there's several proteins involved, several other transcription factors involved, and a whole bunch of other things that go on, and whole other layers of networks are also involved, right? You have a metabolic network layer, you have a gene regulatory network layer, a signaling network layer, and obviously there are a lot of interlayer connections as well. And if you look at any molecule here, it has so many different fates as well, right? So that's something that we seek to understand. What is the flow pattern of metabolites in such a complex network? And if you were to simplify this, the real system from the previous page, it essentially comes down to a long list of reactions. Right? So you have the TCA cycle somewhere here, and you know, you have a long bunch of reactions. So to a modeler, E. coli is this. E. coli is, to a metabolic network modeler, E. coli is a long list of 2,000 reactions or so. Right? So what's a metabolic network? So a nice analogy from a paper in 2001. It's similar to a road network, where you know, isolated roads are similar to, this is the a particular single reaction, a phosphoglucose isomerase. A road map is similar to a metabolic map, and traffic patterns are similar to the flux distributions. Right? So this is really what we seek to understand. Right? So now, what I spoke to you a couple of days ago helps understand this. This already has some information, right? You know that there is some roads are important, some roads are not so important, there are alternate roads, so you know, you have redundancy, whatever. But beyond that, you really do not know how much traffic is actually going through each road, right? And if you did know that, you know which road to widen if you want to increase the traffic in a particular direction. That's your classic metabolic engineering strategy. Or you know, how do you actually control the flow of traffic? How do you stop traffic through a pathogenic organism? How do you shut down traffic? What kind of nodes do you go and manipulate? So these are some of the questions that one tries to ask. How do we reconstruct metabolic networks? And I'm just going to show you one slide, but this happens to be the toughest part of this whole exercise. It, as I mentioned even earlier, it's all fun when you know, somebody gives you a model and you just have to do parameter estimation, simulation, and so on. Actually, constructing the model involves a lot of hard work. And typically, in biological models, it requires a lot of reference to literature. So if somebody has a metabolic model, they must have probably read about, at the least, 50, 60 papers. Right? Talking about the biochemistry of individual enzymes in the model and so on. Because there are a number of things that you require to build a good model. So essentially, you start off with a genome, right? And you assign, so somebody has hopefully already performed the assignment of open reading frames, functional annotation, and so on. And you importantly integrate a lot of information from current literature, of course, biochemistry textbooks and all that. I think this is all a little dated now. Nobody worries about biochemistry textbooks any longer because all this information is already contained in databases, right? So today, if you were to start building a model, all you have to do is take your genome, compare it against all known organisms and try to figure out what are the enzymes that my organism has and how does it, what are all the reactions it can therefore take care of. Right? And then you have three different types of modeling, as I was mentioning. You have kinetic modeling, interaction-based modeling, constraint-based modeling, and so on. Right? And finally, understanding of cellular metabolism and function, and you must keep refining the model. This is what we call the systems biology cycle. Right? You start with a set of hypotheses or some data, you build a model, make some predictions. The predictions may not completely tally. Go and readjust your model. And applications are many. Particularly, you can get interesting biological insights. In metabolic engineering is one of the most popular destinations for constraint-based modeling. And of course, in drug discovery and so on, or drug target identification. And so if anybody wants some more detail, anybody's like really interested in reconstruction of metabolic networks, just ask me a question and I can go into a little more detail. But otherwise, there are like nice databases which already host a lot of models for you to download, analyze, study, and understand. So what is constraint-based modeling? And how can we model very large metabolic networks? Right? So I already mentioned this to you. There are different paradigms, including discrete modeling. And I've kind of convinced you that constraint-based modeling can only be applied to smallish systems. We know that constraints govern all possible biological functions, right? I usually give the example of how tall can a human being be or an elephant be, right? You can't easily have a 20-foot human being because you may not have the heart designed to pump blood to that high, those kinds of heights and so on. This is clearly some constraints, inherent constraints in whatever that we see, whatever phenotypes are observed, right? Organisms often exist in resource-scarce environments, and fitter organisms survive with higher probability, and fitness itself requires satisfying several constraints, which limits the range of phenotypes. So even in a simple example, right, if E. coli is not able to utilize glucose properly, it's going to die, right? And if it does not have a lactose-utilizing enzyme, it cannot grow on milk, right? So there are such clear constraints which limits the range of possible phenotypes. And survival depends on best utilization of resources to survive and grow, always subject to constraints. You cannot wish the constraints away. So there are, what kind of constraints do organisms have to obey? From yesterday. Thermodynamics is like physics, right? It's a law of physics. You can't violate it, right? Thermodynamic constraints have to be obeyed. Similarly, very importantly, stoichiometric constraints have to be obeyed, right? So this is something what Professor Venkatesh was alluding to yesterday. So think of this as a three-dimensional space. I can't show you more in the blackboard anyway. So let's say you have V1. V2 and V3. Again, a disclaimer, we use the word flux, whereas we should technically have been using the word rate, but it's just so rampant in literature that we no longer worry about it. So consider this as three fluxes, right? So any point in space will represent three fluxes, right? Some V1, V2, and V3, right? And you can now put constraints saying, maybe you want to say, you have a constraint saying, you know that V1 is greater than 0, V2 is greater than 0, V3 is greater than 0. And you may also know something like V1 equals 2V2. What does this mean? As a constraint, what does it reflect? It tells you that any solution that you have, right, must lie on that line. V1 equals to V2. Right? Somewhere here, right? That would be the line. V1 equals to V2. Right? So all fluxes will have to lie on that line. But in general, if you had multiple constraints and you end up with a flux cone. You have a cone of possible solutions. This is where your solutions may lie. We'll get a little more clarity as we go on. So since all phenotypes must satisfy constraints, the idea is constraints can eliminate impossible behaviors. Right, like the elimination of suspects that Professor Venkatesh was talking about yesterday. So what kind of constraints? We have environmental constraints, such as pH, temperature, osmolarity, and so on, as well as the available of different carbon sources. Right? If you have lactose, it's a different constraint. If you have glucose, it's a different constraint, and so on. And there are also regulatory constraints. Can you give examples of regulatory constraints? So I want you to think of an example where a cell could potentially is choosing not to do something and doing something else. Right? Given the conditions, it could have done multiple things, but it chooses to do one of those things. So that's a choice that the cell makes, right? Because of its regulatory network, and hopefully it's just trying to maximize its fitness or whatever in the end. The lac operon. What happens when you grow E. coli in a medium containing glucose and lactose? It chooses only to grow on. It chooses to grow on glucose, right? If the glucose concentration were low, it could well take up lactose as well, right? Glucose is not going to fully saturate its the cellular machinery, right? But if the glucose concentration is even low, it will still not utilize lactose, right? Because it tries to get energy from the most effective carbon source or whatever. Right? It's way of maximizing its fitness. Right? So even though these genes are available, these reactions are at your disposal, the cell keeps them off. Right? So that is one kind of regulatory constraint. Another classic regulatory constraint. A cell decides to just shut itself down. Oh, who are the biology folks here? We have a few. Yeah, when does the cell shut itself down? Sporulation. All of you have heard of spores. A cell can just become a spore. It's like the microbial equivalent of hibernation, right? So the cell just tries to, make itself a little more robust to heat or whatever, but stops eating, stops doing much activity at all, right? And hopefully waiting for a time when the conditions could be better, right? So these are actually challenging. So if you looked at it, from a metabolic perspective, nutrients are there. Conditions are seemingly favorable. The cell thinks they are not favorable. You may not immediately realize that, but the cell still does not grow, right? So you just can't apply a mass balance and flux balance and say that, this should be the growth rate, right? So you need to kind of get a handle on these complex constraints that drive the growth of a cell. Right? So what kind of constraints we can impose? Classically, system stoichiometry, directionality of reactions, flux rates, what is the enzyme's turnover? How much of substrate can it convert to product? Right? There's only so much a particular enzyme can do. And even any kinetics that you can bring in, some time constants and so on. And very useful is regulation. Right? And nowadays it's become much easier to integrate regulatory data because you have a lot of transcriptomic data sets available. I mean, it's still a challenge to run some of the simulations, but there's a lot of data available at least. Okay. So let me refresh your memory. What's a stoichiometric matrix? What does it connect? it connects the rates of different reactions to the rate of change of metabolite concentrations. Right? So we always, this is where we start every flux balance problem. So we say that dx by dt S into V. What is X? It's going to be M cross 1, M metabolites. And V, N cross 1, N fluxes, or R fluxes, number of reactions. So what is the stoichiometric matrix size? It's going to be, obviously, M cross N. So can you write out the stoichiometric matrix for this simple system? How many rows? How many rows? Five rows. How many columns? Three columns. Right? Corresponding to R1, R2, R3, or V1, V2, V3. You have minus 1, +2, -1, -2, and +1. Then -1, -3, is it? +1. Is this right? How did we get here? All of you were there yesterday, right? You remember how we got here. So you basically, if you look at the first reaction, dV by dt will be minus V1, right? But, it'll also have some other terms. Minus V1, minus V2, because it's consumed in those two reactions. And in fact, minus V3 as well, right? V is actually being consumed in all three reactions. If you look at C, it'll be +2 V1, -2 V2. Not clear to anyone? Clear to everyone? Okay. Good. So this is the stoichiometric matrix. Yeah, -1, 0, 0, -1, -1, -1, 2, -2, 0, 0, 1, -3, 0, 0, 1. Right? So what is flux balance analysis? You may have often heard of this term if you looked at any computational work in metabolic engineering, they'll usually talk about flux balance analysis. We now look at a steady state mass balance, right? And this is reasonable because, you remember yesterday's growth kinetics curve, right? So that is a lag phase, exponential growth phase, and a stationary phase. So here, it's absolutely fair to assume a steady state mass balance. So what happens now? This becomes equal to 0. So this is kind of where Professor Venkatesh stopped yesterday. So once again, so there are multiple fluxes. So if you look at this picture, there's a small issue here. Do these constraints make sense? Or is there something missing? I mean, are the reactions missing, for example? You're getting ahead. What is the constraint for B? Minus V1, minus V2, minus V3 equal to 0. What kind of constraint is that? So everything is 0. There is no other constraint to balance. So there should be some B coming into the system, right? Some A should, there need to be some transport reactions which bring A into the system, bring B into the system, and take E out of the system. Then you can have a, so if you remember, that was the picture that Professor Venkatesh drew yesterday, right? I think he had some M and P1, P2, and S, I think, something of this sort, right? So you have some substrates coming in, some internal reactions going on, and some stuff that the cell throws out in the end. Right? So you have V1, V2, Vn are the internal fluxes, and B1, B2, Bn are the external fluxes. Don't worry about the notation, but you know, just trying to partition the fluxes. Finally, everything is a reaction for us. And you can put constraints that irreversible reactions operate only in the positive direction. No, we never use infinity. We use something like a large number, right? 1,000 millimole per gram dry weight per hour or something like that. Units of flux, right? Millimole per time per gram dry weight. Reversible reactions can proceed in either direction. So if you get it as plus, it goes in the forward direction. If you get it as minus, it goes in the backward direction. Whatever. It's the net flux, of course. And external fluxes can also be in either direction. Assuming, you know that it can happen in either direction. You can also fix them in a particular direction. You know that if something is only secreted, hell has no machinery to transport it inside, you can say that it goes only in one direction. Okay. So how do we solve this system of equations? What system is this? It's a linear system of equations. How many unknowns? How many unknowns? N. What are the unknowns here? What is it that we are trying to find out? Fluxes. So your unknowns are equal to the number of reactions. Every reaction has a flux. You want to find out those fluxes, you have N unknowns. How many equations? M. M equations. Where do they arise from? Rate of change of, there's no accumulation of any metabolite. Right? D M by dt is 0. Dx1 by dt is 0. Dx2 by dt is 0. If x1, xn are your metabolites, rate of change of any metabolite is the overall, balance, Is this familiar from somewhere else? This mass balance. This is identical to something you've studied in 11th standard physics. Kirchhoff's law. No difference. Right? You know what are all the wires carrying current in, carrying charge out? There is charge balance. Right? That's charge balance, here it is mass balance. Good. So how do we solve the system of equations? You have M equations and N unknowns. Again, 11th standard. Right, I can actually teach this to 11th standard students because all the math background is finished by 11th standard. So how do you solve a system of M equations and N unknowns? What are the scenarios? The first question you should ask me is M greater than, equal to, or less than N? What happens when M equals N? Unique solution. What is that solution? Zero. Right? It has a unique solution. You know zero works for this equation, so zero is the solution. Right? What happens when M is less than N? Which means the number of equations is much less than number of unknowns. You have how many solutions? infinite solutions. Well, you have like so many people with the highest degree in math and yeah, if I just asked you V1 plus V2 equals 10, how many solutions can you give me? Infinite solutions, you know, 1, 9, 1.1, 8.9, whatever, right? So you can give me infinitely many solutions. What happens if M is greater than N? The number of equations is higher than the number of unknowns. They may not even be consistent. So you may want to find a solution that, you know, mostly fits this, you know, approximately fits everything. You can do least squares and all this stuff. What do you expect to happen, where are my biologists? What do you expect to happen in a metabolic network, a biological system? Do you expect the stoichiometric matrix to be fat or tall? So do you expect M to be less than N or greater than N? And you have to tell me why. Yeah, so that's correct. So you have a relatively smaller number of metabolites because the same metabolites are mixed and matched in multiple reactions. Right, glucose will interact with, you know, ATP, glucose will interact with something else. You know, G6P will interact with alanine and whatever. Right, you have all kinds of mixing and matching between metabolites happening. So the same metabolites participate in many more reactions. Right, given that you have a fat matrix. So now you have infinitely many solutions. How do you eliminate the solution? You start putting your constraints. But if you are... Since most of you are mathematicians, you will now see that you still have a smaller infinity number of solutions, right? It's still an infinite space that we have. How do you pick one solution out of this? Which comes down to the previous question I asked you. How do you solve, how do you give me the most useful solution, if there is one, to V1 plus V2 equals 10? I have to give you some other constraint, right? So I might tell you, give me solutions such that V1 and V2 are as close to each other as possible. Then you'll say V1 equals V2 equals 5. You have a solution, right? So here what we do is we want to second guess what the cell is trying to do. So remember, what's our ultimate goal? Our ultimate goal is not to just solve the set of equations, but to predict the rate of every reaction that is happening within the cell. So if you figure out what the cell is trying to do, you might be able to predict a set of rates that are, you know, aligned with the cellular objective. And it turns out that a very good cellular objective is maximize growth. Under certain conditions, of course. Obviously, under sporulation, under starvation, that's not going to work out. But under certain conditions, it is going to work out if you want to... So if you maximize growth, you are going to get a flux solution, or what we call a flux distribution, that is, you know, very closely aligns with what's really happening within the cell. Right? So, what kind of an optimum? So, if I were to say maximize V1 such that SV equal to 0, what is it mathematically? Not somebody who knows, somebody who doesn't know, who's not seen this before. I have a linear system of equations, and I have a linear objective function. What is this technique called? Optimization technique called? Optimization problem called? It's an LP. It's a linear program. Right? Again, 11th standard. Where have you encountered linear programs? So there's a factory that can produce tables and chairs. It can produce, you know, X number of tables, Y number of chairs per day. If your profit on chair is this much, table is this much, what number of chairs and tables must you produce to maximize profit? Right? Most of you remember that. How are you solving that problem, by the way? Do you remember? So you would draw it on a graph paper and... of course, you are only interested in the first quadrant. You will, in fact, you would draw, I think you draw the graph paper and you will start shading this area or something, saying, you know, because this is one constraint, right? This is V2 greater than 0. And this is V1, of course, this is equal to 0. What I'm saying is this area is greater than 0, right? And then you may have a constraints, linear constraints of this sort, right? And you may have an objective function which is maximize V1 plus V2 or something like that. Right? So you will essentially look at the intersection points because that's where the solutions lie and see what's most optimal and things like that. One thing that you can imagine is, let's say this is my constraint space, right? This is some linear function of V1 and V2. This is another linear function of V1 and V2, right? So I said these are constraints based on some stoichiometry, and now I have to draw an objective function. My objective function could just be maximize V1, right? Which means just go as far as possible on this. Right? Or it could be something else, or it could be, let's say, it's for some reason aligned with this. That is my objective function. Some alpha V1 plus beta V2 plus C, right? How many optima do you have? Again, infinite, right? All these are optima. Right? So there is no real guarantee of a unique solution. So that's the first thing. We'll kind of dig deeper into that as we go on. So now, I've sort of told you that one optimization function that we can use is profit, right? In the charitable case, the same thing in the biological system is growth rate. Right, and instead of chairs and tables and all that, you maximize, alanine, glucose, fructose, everything is all mixing up and, you know, giving you a growth. How do you frame this growth equation? We'll look at it in a little while. Right. So for the moment, let's just assume you are taking some linear function of the fluxes and optimizing them. So typically, we maximize growth or minimize nutrient uptake, maximize metabolic production. You can maximize the Euclidean norm of the flux vector, multiple things you can do. This basically boils down to a linear programming problem. Minimize or maximize some C into V such that SV is 0. Right? So this basically means some large set of linear equations in V, and this is one linear equation in V. Not an equation, a function. And you can extend this framework very peacefully to do lots of in silico analysis like gene deletion, drug inhibition, for metabolic engineering purposes, whatever. Any questions so far? Is everything that we've discussed so far clear? Very good. So let's now look at a simple illustration of FBA. So that's not technically balanced, this reaction. But let's say you have A coming in and ATP going out, and one reaction, and A coming in, NADH going out, having another reaction. So you can see that X1 plus X2 is RA. Right? Whatever flux comes in gets partitioned here. So these are your, very similar to this, admissible solutions. So if you say maximize ATP, then you will go on this axis, X1 axis, and this will be your optimal solution. If you maximize NADH, this will be your optimal solution. Here's a very, very toy example. Let's look at a better example in the next slide. So the biggest challenge here in FBA is, how do you come up with this magical objective function? Right? Because obviously you can imagine that if you change the objective function, you'll get a different solution. Right? And you want to get a solution that very closely aligns with biology. It has to be experimentally valid. Otherwise, you know, no model is useful unless you have any experimental validation. Right? So it essentially turns out that assuming maximization, if you assume maximization of growth rate, you get a very good alignment with the biology, the data. Right, so it's useful to use this objective function. You can use other objective functions. For example, you may want to just probe the solution space. What's happening? Right. So what is the In fact, this is a very useful contribution from something like flux balance analysis. What is the maximum amount of penicillin that can be produced by this organism? Right? And if you know that you're already producing 95% of that in the lab, don't worry about metabolic engineering. Right? But if you're only producing 40% of that, there's like so much room for improvement. You may want to examine knockouts and various other ways to manipulate and so on. Right? To represent likely physiological objectives, that's essentially what we try to do when we say biomass. To represent bioengineering design objectives, I want to maximize penicillin. I want to figure out, you know, how do I reroute the traffic in the cell so that I produce more of something that I want. So I once again note that biomass production works well in general, but may not be valid in all situations. Obviously, if the cell is under starvation, it's not going to maximize its growth. It's going to optimize something else. And you have to go and figure out what that optimization is. Yeah, so you may minimize nutrient production, nutrient uptake, and so on. Okay, let's walk through a simple illustration. So can I write out the stoichiometric matrix for the system as well? So that you know the concept is firmly stuck in your head. First, what is the size of the stoichiometric matrix? Five cross, very good. Right, you see A, B, C, D, E, you immediately tell me it is five cross. Five cross? Seven. Yeah, two is the internal part and five is the external part. I've given an exchange flux pertaining to every single metabolite in the system. Right, for A, B, C, D, E, you already have exchange fluxes. And you have, two internal reactions, V1 and V2 for the two reactions that are shown. And one small issue with this figure, which tells you that B4, B5 can go in either direction, but it doesn't tell you which direction. So when you draw it, you may want to put it in one direction, so that then you get B4 as minus Y, it goes in the opposite direction. Right? You have to commit to one direction when you write out the stoichiometric matrix. So if you tried writing it out, this is what it looks like, 5x7 matrix. I basically put some dots here to partition the matrix. It's not at all important. It's just to give you an idea of there are some internal fluxes and some exchange fluxes. What are the next step? dx by dt is SV equal to 0. Now you have how many equations? 5 equations, 7 unknowns, right? Can you add more constraints? Yes. I seem to know some biology, and I say that 0 less than V1 less than 10, minus 10 less than V2 less than 10, minus 10 less than whatever. So this is where, you know, your biological knowledge comes. Typically, this involves saying there's so much glucose available for uptake. What are your real constraints? Right? How much glucose is available for uptake? How much nitrogen is available for uptake and so on? You did see the concept of limiting substrate and monod kinetics and so on, right? So those substrates are going to actually constrain what's the final growth rate and so on. And now I'm basically saying that B is my biomass or B is what I want to maximize. So what are the maximum B that can be produced? Can I actually solve it by hand? Not even rigorously, I think you can guess a solution. Can you guess a solution for me? Because all you have to do is, you have to satisfy SV equal to 0, which actually doesn't seem to be very difficult, right? Because if you write this out, it only means V1 equals B1, V1 equals V2 plus B2, so many of these are potentially independent constraints, right? As long as you obey this. Can somebody give me a set of solutions. How would you start going about it? What would be the value of B2? Hundred. It would violate this constraint. B2 has to be 10. Because you're trying to maximize B2, and the maximum value that B2 can take is 10. So assuming 10 is possible, you know, if you then, I'm just trying to give you a sort of intuitive feel, right? If you, this is not the rigorous way to do it, right? But you then say that B2 is 10, right? Which means potentially V2 is some number smaller than 10 and B3 is equal to V2. This is a constraint, right? So one solution could be 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 10. Right? So if you actually punch these into MATLAB, for some reason it gives you these numbers. Doesn't like 5 and 5, it's too round for it. It gives you 5.1 and 4.9. Right? So you have 4.8, 4.8, 4.8, 4.8, 5, 5, 5. Okay. Obviously, there are more than one solution. The constraints aren't enough to limit my solutions. I still have infinitely many solutions. But one thing is important is, this is the most important thing about flux balance analysis, the objective function value is unique. B2 is 10 is non-negotiable. You can have different configuration of the other fluxes that can give you B2 equals 10. But B2 equals 10 is unique. It is the solution. And that is the one value that you should trust from flux balance analysis. Right? You shouldn't, there are other concepts, we'll try to go into them maybe a little later on or certainly in the next lecture. Yep. So the constraints have to be added from the knowledge of biology. Right? So for example, these constraints are easy. I just say 0 less than V less than infinity. My infinity is 10 here. In general, you use 1,000 is the value that people use because no flux in a cell usually goes beyond 1,000 millimole per gram dry weight per hour or something like that. But typically, you know, even though these are like, you have like a lot of room for these fluxes, they're all going to be constrained by your initial glucose flux. The other analogy I like is you can try to visualize this whole thing as a massive system of interconnected pipes. Right? You have an extremely complex pipe network where water is coming through, and you have certain taps at the top, you know, where you pour the input water, and then you know it goes through different pipes. The wall position in all the intermediate pipes decides the rate of the reactions and so on. And you have one pipe at the bottom where you are finally collecting water. So what is the flow rate in that? It is going to depend upon everything else. Right? Ideally, it's going to be the flow rate of what you pour at top. Right? But if some wall is really constrained, rate limiting step kind of thing, some wall is like really closed, that is going to limit what's going to come here. Right? So this is what you get to study. So we'll try to do some examples like this in the lab in the afternoon. So you'll see when does, you know, glucose saturate the system or something like that. But otherwise, till it gets saturated, as you keep increasing glucose, you'll get a nice linear increase in growth rate. So, to answer your question, the constraints have to come from some knowledge of biology. There's no... where are these constraints coming from? Okay. So, tell me how many constraints are there in this... on this figure? So 5 constraints on the variables, but you have... you already have... those equations are themselves constraints, right? So you have, you have 7 constraints on the variables and you have 5 constraints here, right? So this is a classic, all of you seem to already have your laptop. You just fire up help linprog. So you can see that what is a classical linear program in MATLAB. Don't bother, just look at somebody else's screen. Don't bother taking your laptop out for this. Or maybe I'll just get it. Can you see it? Yeah. So look at this part. Linprog F A B A equal B equal L B U B. I'll explain to you what each of these are. F as you would imagine, is what's the corresponding variable for FBA? C. I kept saying, no, minimize C transpose V, maximize C transpose V. It is the objective function. F is the objective function. What is A? No, look at it closely. It's a trick question. There is no A. Because we do not have any inequality constraints. We have only equality constraints. So A and B are empty, as you would feed into MATLAB. A eq and B eq are your, A eq is S, stoichiometric matrix. What is B eq? Zero vector, right hand side. SV equal to zero. These are your other inequality constraints, lower bound and upper bound. You don't usually put them here, but you put them here. LV, UV. That's it. So now you know how to solve at least that toy problem using MATLAB. It will probably start with that in the afternoon. You can just punch that matrix into MATLAB. I'll show you that slide. You punch that matrix into MATLAB, feed in all of that. You will get that same 4.857, 5.143 solution that I was showing you. Okay, so let's move on. Okay. So let's try to understand FBA a little more. So earlier this year, I spent an entire class just talking about this one slide. So there are some really important things to understand from FBA. So this is the practice of FBA. This is not something you will find in a general textbook or something like that. First thing is reconstruction. What is the information that you need in the reconstruction? I just happily told you need a long list of reactions, 1 to 2,000. What other information do you actually need? You need some information about the constraints, right? And I'm kind of preempting this, but you also need to know what kind of, what proteins catalyze what reaction and so on. Right, because at some point of time, we want to start doing some gene deletion studies. Right, so you need to know what's known as the GPR association. I'll come back to that. And standards are a huge problem. How many of you have seen SBML? How many of you are seeing this for the first time, this acronym? Okay, that's a large number. So it stands for Systems Biology Markup Language. So then you should also visit biomodels.net. So biomodels.net has hundreds of models, maybe thousands, over 1,000 models from published literature. So if you wrote a paper, with a small signaling network model, very likely somebody put it on biomodels. Right? Obviously, now actually you should go and put it on biomodels. But if somebody wrote a paper in the last 15 years with a signaling network model or a metabolic network model, kinetic models typically, right? They're all on biomodels. Biomodels also has many automatically curated this flux models and things like that. So, but there's a lot of issue in terms of the standards and things like that. For example, how do you represent this? How do you represent the constraints? Right, there is no clear agreement in the community. So there are like some ad hoc and de facto standards, but there's no serious. There is some FBC standard that's coming up, flux balance constraints for SBML and so on. These are things you need to worry about if you ever code a model by hand. If you want to just download a model like we are going to do in the afternoon and run simulations, you don't have to worry about it. But anybody who is like serious about constraint-based analysis needs to look into SBML, SBML, FBC, and so on. Right? And if you ever curate a model, every entity in your model must be mappable to some database. In the sense, if you say glucose, I need to know what it is, right? You should then say that, this is C00267 in keg, right? Then I know it is alpha D glucose. Right? If you just say glucose, I don't know whether it is beta D glucose, alpha D glucose, L glucose even, right? Unlikely it's L glucose because you're talking about biological systems, but you have to be precise, right? And you know, somebody will say GLC is glucose, somebody will say GLC is glycine. So you will see all these kinds of issues when you look at models in the public domain. So when you want to compare models and all that, it becomes very challenging. So make sure that if you ever build a model, you have to stick to some standards. There are enough papers that talk about standards. We also have some work which talks about the need for these standards and so on. The next tricky part is growth. Right? All along I was telling you maximize growth. What is growth? What is biomass? And biomass is actually cellular mass, right? So what is that composed of? All the stuff that's there in the cell. So you need to actually write out an equation. This is similar to the, you know, nutrition information that you find on your chocolate bar, right? There's some X amount of protein, Y amount of carbohydrate, Z amount of fat, right? So here similarly, we break it down into some of the most important components. You know, a bit of glucose and you know, all the amino acids practically, and some nucleotides and so on. Then also ATP production and whatever. Right? There's some ATP, so on the right hand side, and water and all those. So essentially write a fictitious equation with about 50, say 60 metabolites producing biomass. And biomass is also a fictitious metabolite. Right? Or it could just, you know, just overall indicate production of ATP or, you know, something of that sort. But it's a fictitious equation that one needs to write out. It is there in all the models. So when we open up a model in the afternoon, we'll take a look at this. So another challenge is there are what are known as dead end metabolites in these models. What's a dead end metabolite? So this metabolite is produced, but not further used in the system. So what should happen to this metabolite? It should actually accumulate in the system. But if it says there's no accumulation, which means, you know, nothing can accumulate, which means this metabolite should not even be produced, which means this precursor won't be produced, which means that entire branch won't be produced, or whatever, right? So these are some issues that you, so the classic example is, you know, if you, you know, create a model and grow it, you'll get zero growth rate. And you'll have to start debugging it, and these are some of the first things that one will find out. You'll see that, you know, there is no growth because, you know, maybe the medium has not been properly specified, but because there's some metabolite you've not put in, and you actually can account for this by putting an exchange flux corresponding to this. If, say, E is not being used up in your system, if you put an exchange flux for E, that E can be pumped out of the system and, you know, the rest of the system can work fine. There's no more necessity for E to be, E to accumulate in the cell, right? And there are what are known as blocked reactions, right? So typically, let's say you have a system, you have A giving B, B giving C, then E giving F. You don't know how C goes to F. So C is potentially a dead-end metabolite, and so is F. Right? It is a metabolite, so dead-end also applies to metabolites that are only used but never produced. So anything that occurs only on the left-hand side or only on the right-hand side is a potential dead-end metabolite. Why do these exist? Incomplete knowledge, right? You know, you have strong evidence for certain reactions. You don't know how, say, C goes to F. I know that A goes to B, B goes to C, then F goes to G, G goes to H. I have no idea about C, D, E, F. Or, you know, if there are more than one metabolite or less than a few metabolites connecting C to F, right? So, but usually these will all be in your model. If you take this classic human model called RECON, RECON 2 has about 40% blocked reactions. Okay. Blocked reactions also include reactions that are blocked in the current medium. Right? All your lactose reactions are blocked in a glucose medium. right? They won't usually take flux. Yeah. Yes. Some blocked reactions may activate if, you know, the medium is there or something like that. Right? But there are other permanently blocked reactions which are there because, I mean, you leave them in because you know those reactions are there, and hopefully, you know, somebody else fills the gap later on. Right? So you have biochemical evidence pertaining to this reaction, but you don't know how, you know, two metabolites are bridged actually. And perhaps we can use something like the tool I gave a talk about the previous day to predict what could be the pathway between these two and fill the gap. Something of that sort. But there are actually a large number of gap filling algorithms already though. Okay. And then the other very important concept I've been trying to tell you is there is no unique solution, right? You have infinitely many solutions, but what is guaranteed is your objective function value. You have many different flux distributions that can result in the same objective function, but the objective function by itself is unique. So how do we study this? Right? So one very useful thing to look at is what are the extremities of the space? You have a flux space. It is some flux space and it usually ends up being a convex flux cone. So one way to look at this is to find out what is the least V1 What is the least value of any reaction and max value of any reaction that a reaction can take if you have to satisfy maximum growth? Obviously, whenever I say such that, I should say those are inviolable stoichiometric constraints. And I can also write your upper and lower bounds. These are your classic constraints, permanent constraints. In addition, I'm saying have ensure maximum biomass flux. What is my objective function now? Maximize VI or minimize VI. So you'll set the objective, you'll set the LP as maximize VI such that SV equal to 0 and alpha I less than VI less than beta I. Or minimize VI, V1, such that alpha I less than VI less than beta I and SV equal to 0. And V by O equals V by O max. Is that fine? So this technique is known as flux variability analysis or FVA. We already looked at FBA, flux balance analysis, the flux variability analysis. So FVA gives you a very good handle on the solution space itself. You know which fluxes are, you know, have lot more variation and which fluxes are much more tight and things like that. For any condition, you can look at flux variability corresponding to any condition. So what's a blocked reaction now with FVA in the picture? Min and max are both zero. Right. The cell is growing,
But if you try to maximize this reaction, it can't go beyond zero. If you try to minimize this reaction also, it can't go below zero. Flux variability for the reaction is zero. I want to move on to perturbations, but probably it's better doing that after the break. We will just have a quick discussion. What kind of perturbations will you do to a cell? Delayed reaction or? What's the opposite? Add a reaction or overexpress an enzyme, right? You want to potentially model all these scenarios. What happens when you try to overexpress something? What happens when you try to delete one or more reactions? Right? How does the cell behave? So let's come back and think about how we would go ahead doing this. How would we model the removal of a gene or the addition of a gene or the overexpression of a gene? You know, what would be the math that's involved? How would you predict the best kind of manipulations? What would be the best manipulation? Yeah. I don't care about any of them. I just look at what are the enzymes, right? So what are my enzymes? So I'm essentially only worried about what kind of reactions are there inside the cell, for which I need to worry about what kind of enzymes are there. They could be on the plasmid or on the chromosome, I don't mind. Right? Can the cell drive the reaction or not? So that might, that's going to be a function of what? Expression, right? It's the expression values might change. I can, there are ways to, you can change your constraint appropriately. You know, if it's a plasmid gene, you might give it a slightly lower, you know, value or something. And if it's a chromosome integrated, you might, you know, increase the upper bound or something like that. Any other questions? Yeah. Very good. So you can actually do compartmentalization as well, right? So every compartment will have its own balance. Right? So now you no longer have glucose, but you have glucose mitochondria, glucose cytoplasm, glucose chloroplast, whatever.
Is that different?
Yes, yes. So, so what is it that we were doing all along? We were doing this, right? This is a cell. There is some substrate. There is some product. And another product. Something of this sort. Right? That's biomass, right? But internally, lots of interesting things could be happening. Right? And each of these could have a different flux, right? So now you have many more metabolites than before, right? So you have, say, S, and let's call this compartment A, compartment B, compartment C. So S giving SA is a reaction. SA giving SB is a reaction. What are these reactions biologically? Transport. It could be active transport, multiple types of transport, whatever. Right? You have transport reactions as well that you need to consider. And the flux has to be balanced across all these reactions. Right? Your stoichiometric matrix has become a little, just got a little more complicated now. So for yeast, we do have a very good compartmentalized model. And I think even the human, so compartmentalization within the cell is one thing. You also have tissue-specific models, right? So when I say a human model, it's a generic human model. Now kidney will have a different model, brain would have a different model, liver would have a different model. People are usually very interested in the liver because liver is the
Action, it's where a lot of action is happening with respect to metabolism. But you know, you might want to look at muscle. It's going to be missing a few key enzymes. Like there's no gluconeogenesis in the muscle, I think, for example. So you're going to have a different set of reactions that are active. Yeah, perhaps all of this will get, you know, a little more clarity when we start talking about the perturbations. Right. So currently what we assume is that every reaction that is there in the model is on in the cell. Not a very fair assumption. So with this background, what would happen if I grew E. coli on a medium containing glucose and lactose and predicted the solution using flux balance analysis? There is no gene expression information. I assume that all reactions are available at my disposal. So the growth rate will be higher than real, right? So the growth rate on glucose is some 6 and lactose is 4, you would get a growth rate of 10 here. But you know, this is actually again proof that bad models are useful. This just seems atrocious, right? You know, any biologist would squirm at the thought of you know, not considering the lac operon. But yeah, thankfully, you know, we don't usually simulate it in like complex media and things like that. You know, in metabolic engineering purposes, we usually have like a well-defined medium where, you know, if there is going to be catabolite repression, you jolly well integrate that in the model. And it's not very difficult to do that, right? You can just put up some constraints saying, if V glucose is greater than something, then V lactose equal to 0. Which means you need to slightly change your modeling paradigm, but no big deal. There are techniques such as RFBA, regulatory flux balance analysis, which can consider such constraints and such some sort of dynamics, if you will. Okay then, so let's break for tea, and at 11:30 we'll start looking at perturbations to these genome scale models.